The book of Psalms, chapter number 8. Amen. I'm not going to reference this a whole lot because I know who's here and I appreciate it. But it's tough when it's Super Bowl Sunday, huh? I'm glad to have the Lord first. Amen. So thank you for making him first. I made my mind up against anything this morning. I'm just referencing it tonight. Just, you know, from Super Bowl to halftime entertainment, which always seems to be controversial, by the way, to the newest of commercials. I'd rather have old-time religion.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. I'd rather just have Jesus. And so I'm just thankful for that tonight. And I appreciate you being here. There are so many in our church that are sick. Let's just be praying for them. And we're going to weather the storm, and we're going to make it through. Psalms chapter number 8, and I just want to draw our attention to a few things tonight in the Psalm of David. Let's read together. The Bible says, O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth, who has set your glory above the heaven. Out of the mouths of babes and sucklings have you ordained strength because of your enemies, that you might still the enemy and the avenger. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, and the moon and the stars which thou hast, which you have ordained, what is my man that you are mindful of him, and the son of man that you visit him? For you have made him a little lower than the angels and have crowned him with glory and honor. You made him to have dominion over the works of your hands and have put all things under his feet. All sheep and oxen, yea, and the beasts of the field, the fowl of the air, the fish of the sea, and whatsoever passes through the paths of the sea. O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. What is man that thou art mindful of him, and the son of man that thou visitest him? Amen. Amen. That God would visit us. Amen. A few things I want to say here as we look at this psalm. I won't look at every verse tonight, but I'd like to look at a few things that I feel are important or that has caught my attention as I have studied. But David is the one who is writing this, and maybe to refresh your memory on some things, that when you look at Psalms chapter number 3 through Psalm chapter number 41, David writes all these psalms with the exception of 2, and that being Psalms 10 and Psalms number 33. And there's some things that we do know about David as he is writing these psalms, that David was a skillful harp player. We read that in 1 Samuel chapter number 16. And he was known as the sweetest psalmist of Israel in 2 Samuel chapter number 23. And then he was an accomplished songwriter, and he had an active role in 1 Chronicles chapter number 16. He had a very active role in shaping the way that Israel would worship God. In fact, even to this day, the way that David shaped is still the way that Israel worships God. So it's so amazing to think about that the psalm writer David has wrote this psalm, and that it is a hymn that can be sung. And the amazing thing about David is David wasn't a man who just brought songwriting to the table 1 or 2 days a week. But David was an avid songwriter and singer who loved to play the harp. And we'll talk about some other instruments here in a few minutes. Amen. David loved to play those instruments, and he loved to sing to God. Amen. Because it was what the heart of David rested in. It was the anthem of his soul. And so David writes these songs as he worships God. And when we look at Psalms chapter number 8, we can see that it certainly is a hymn that is to be sung among the Psalms. We can look at it about the hymns, that we look at the hymns and they bring out great truths about God as they would be sung. Brother Josh, you can look at Psalms chapter number 9 and Psalms chapter number 30, and you would find that those psalms that were written, Brother Dennis, as a thanksgiving to God for prayers that He answered, Sister Stacy. And then you look at the celebratory way that he wrote about abiding in the law of God and being righteous to please God. You can sing that in that long Psalm 119. So all these psalms are given to us for many reasons. And then you can sing Psalms number 23. We all know that. And you can sing it with the confidence that no matter where you're at or what you're going through, that God is going through it with you. And so these psalms are all written, much like our hymnal, to give us different aspects of who God is and what this relationship with God that we have is all about. Mm-hmm. And we look here, actually, there's even some prophetic things that's given here in Psalms 8. But we look at, in Psalms chapter 81, there's lots of prophetic things that is given, even in Psalms that it's sung about. We sing, "We shall see the King." We sing that because it encourages us, one day we're going to see the King. And so David is writing these songs and he is singing them because it is worship to God. And particularly in this psalm, he is looking at creation and who we are in creation. And as we sing about it, we think about the majesty of God. I don't know if you've ever looked and you've noticed, but you'll see that some psalms and some Bibles have written above it to the chief musician upon Gittith as it introduces the Psalm of David. Did you ever see that? To the chief musician, the Psalm of David upon Gittith. If you look in your Bible, some of you will see that written above the Psalm. Did you ever look and wonder what that meant? Or you just think, man, that's kind of lofty, or it's kind of a different language, and I don't really understand what it means. Well, I think as we look at this psalm tonight, Brother Josh, it's really important as we're talking, Sister Rachel, about singing to God, that we look at what does this mean, the chief musician upon Gittith. Gittith was a harp that was similar to a guitar, and it was an instrument that was very common to a land called Gath. Any of you ever hear about Gath in the Bible? In fact, if you look at Gath and you understand what Gath is, there'll be one really big man that you'll think about that came from Gath. And his name is Goliath of Gath. And so here, David, how ironic. Now, it wasn't just ironic. How divinely placed that God wrote that David was going to write all these hymns, Sister Sandy. They were going to be songs that we were going to sing about God. And he was going to write it as he played upon the Gittith, this guitar, this instrument that came from Gath. But it was going to, Sister Stacy, it was going to be something that was just more than irony. But it was going to be talking about, Sister Beth, how that we can take and make songs out of those crazy situations in life where there's giants that we face, amen, big battles that we face, victories that are won, amen. God takes those struggles in our life, amen, that eventually becomes victories, and He makes a song out of it. Hallelujah! Who but God can do that? And so when we look at this, all the power that comes in knowing that God is the Redeemer of the battle. So everything that you and I face in life, the situations, big or small, how they may seem, maybe it seems insignificant, but God helps us through. Or whether God takes big battles and He says, you know what, I'm going to give you a song to sing out of that. Hallelujah. God doesn't waste our trials. God's a Redeemer of the ready. God uses situations to bring glory to His name. And so, even in those fights that seem taxing, here it is that there is an instrument that comes from God that becomes an instrument of worship. God wants us to sing, even when we go through difficult times. God wants to take our difficult times and make them a song of victory. Praise God. Who but God, who divinely orchestrates. And so don't lose the connection of what's happening here. And knowing when he says, "Oh Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth." Here, David is drawing worship to God because of the glory that he reveals of himself in creation. Amen. And who that he is. And so he says, "How excellent is your name in all the earth, who has set your glories above the heavens." Amen. God's glory is in all the earth. So he takes us back to a time where we're remembering in the book of Genesis, God creates the earth. And then God takes the dust of the earth and he creates man. And then Sister Tiffany, from the man, he creates woman. And he says, "How excellent is your creation in all the earth. The glory of who you made." You know that person that you love that's sitting beside you? Amen. God made them. Amen. Glory to God for them. Amen. For your spouse, for your child, for the brother or sister that you have. Amen. God made them. Glory be to God. How excellent is God. He made them. He created them. The miracle of creation. And so then God says something, or David says something. He said, "Out of the mouths of babes and suckling give ordained strength because of your enemy, that you might steal the enemy and the avenger." The enemy wants to rob all the glory from God. He does. He wants you to make you think that the trial that you go through, God doesn't care about you, and God is not giving you a song to sing. The enemy makes you want to forget that God's going to take an instrument from this. Amen. I'm going to let you play on it for His glory. The Word of God says that God has a way of silencing the enemy. Praise God. So whatever the enemy is saying, God's forgot about you. God's not concerned. God, look, he's allowing you to go through this. How can God love you? That's the enemy. God wants to silence him. Oh Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. David gives us an understanding of the majesty of the name of God. Now, I've got to take you back once again to that whole thing with the gith, the guitar, that instrument that's from Gath. Do you remember when David was fighting the enemy who was trying to defile the armies of the living God? He came out day and night, "Who will fight me?" And everyone was shuddering because of this giant. You know, he was head and shoulders above the rest. We can't fight him. He's bigger. And so David, he says this. Listen to what David said. He went down by the brook and he had gathered 5 smooth stones. And he had a sling. But I want you to notice what he was focusing on. In 1 Samuel 17, verse number 45, the Bible says, "Then David said to the Philistines, 'Thou comest to me with sword and with spear and with a shield, but I come to thee in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the enemy, or the armies of Israel, whom thou hast defiled. This day will the Lord deliver thee into mine hand, and I will smite thee, and I will take thine head from thee, and I will give the carcasses of the hosts of the Philistines this day unto the fowls of the air, and to the wild beasts of the earth, that the earth may know that there is a God in Israel." David didn't come and say, "Listen, you're coming against me with spear and sword." He said, "I'm coming with you with a slingshot and 5 stones. And that's all he said. He said, "You're coming against me with spear and sword and shield. But I am coming against you in the name of the Lord." Mm-hmm. David said, it's not the slingshot. It's not the stones. You can come against me with whatever you want. Amen. But I come against you in the name of the Lord of Israel, the one who is going to be glorified when I take your carcass and the fowls of the air eat upon it, and God is going to be glorified. And now David says here, as he's playing this instrument, amen, from Gath, he said, wait a second. Oh Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. He knew about the name of God. He already fought Goliath in the name of God, so he knew how excellent the name of God is in all the earth. Praise God. The Word of God says this. Amen. That one day Peter and John was walking to the temple, and they passed the one who was lame. Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have in the name of Jesus, the name of God. It's the one that heals. It's the one that delivers. It's the one that sets free. Amen. The Word of God reminds us that there is one name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. David said, oh Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. Devil, you're a liar. When I speak the name of Jesus, fear has got to go. Sickness has got to subside. Peace has got to go, and fear is delivered. Amen. At the name of Jesus, how excellent is your name in all the earth. There's power in the name of the Lord. Amen. The Bible says that when the name of the Lord is spoken, down in verse number 2, that it will still the enemy. We have an enemy of our soul. Hey, listen to me. There's an enemy who will fight against your soul that will do whatever he can do to discourage you spiritually. But the name of Jesus steals the enemy. There's an enemy that's against marriages that will try to destroy what God has brought together. But the name of Jesus, it steals the enemy, and marriages are restored. Mm-hmm. There's an enemy that comes against the family, causing friction and division and feuding. But at the name of Jesus, the enemy is still. Oh Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. You know what? God knows how to work and move. Amen. The number of those who are against him are nothing. We read, and you are familiar, we'll reference it often, that in the Red Sea, God killed all of those Egyptians who were coming against the people of God. The sea shut up. But do you know what? If you read in the book of Isaiah, chapter number 37, you'll read about Sennacherib, who came against the people of God. You'll read how that the angels come down, and there was 185,000 who were put to death because they came against the people of God. Let me tell you what, God has a way of silencing the enemy.
Mm-hmm.
God can do it. Amen. We have to put our trust in him tonight. David went on down to say, when I consider your heavens and the work of your fingers, and the moon and the stars, which you've ordained. What is man that thou art mindful of him, and the son of man that thou visitest him? It's amazing. David brings the scope of creation in, and he takes us back and makes us begin to think about creation, how great God is. Now, when Moses wrote the Pentateuch way back in Genesis, he said this. He said, and God made two great lights, the greater to rule by day and the lesser to rule by night. And then it almost seems like Moses then just throws in this little phrase. And he says, and he made the stars also. Let me stop here. Could I just bring your attention to God and the glory of God and who he is? Amen. He takes the enemy, amen, his territory, and he gives us a song to sing upon his instrument. Amen. God changes it. Here it is, that light travels at the rate of 186,000 miles per second. That's crazy to think about. even more and more on a plane, we don't fly a fraction of what that is. So here it is, Brother Dennis, that light is traveling at 186,000 miles per second. And so when the sun begins to beam in the morning, that means that when light started its trek toward us, now hold on, I have some good stuff to say. When light started its trek toward us this morning, Brother Josh, we did not see it till 8 minutes later. Wow. That's crazy. That's crazy to think about those numbers. 186,000 miles per second when the light began to shine this morning, when God allowed the sun to shine down on us, Sister Stacy, and it wasn't until 8 minutes later. That means that if the sun started shining upon our part of the earth at 6 o'clock, Sister Sandy, we didn't see it till 6:08. That is how big this universe is. Wow. Wow. That God would do that. And you know what? It takes place every morning. I'm thankful for the mornings, Brother Doug, when I don't have to be up to see it. Call it what you will, but I'm thankful for those mornings. But there are a lot of mornings where I am up to see it. But Sister Tiffany, you know what? I just take it for granted. It's another day, and that's what's going to happen. Shouldn't be that way. Because the mercies of God are new every day. Amen. What is man that thou art mindful of him in this big creation of the world? Man, I'm talking big. Some folks think when we travel to Harrisburg, it's big. Amen. That's nothing. And you may travel to some big old cities that have many, many, many lakes, and that's still nothing, you know. But when we travel, amen, and we begin to look at who God has created us to be in this universe, what is man that thou art mindful of? Wow, this is big, this is huge, but God knows us. When the Voyager 2 reached Neptune and it started sending images back to NASA, still traveling, sending images back as quick as that light is, at 186,000 miles per second, those were the radio waves, it still took 4 hours, Brother Josh, for them to get a picture back that they had taken on the Voyager 2. Now when you think about that Neptune is not even on the outer ring of the planets, but Pluto is beyond it, this universe is big. It's huge. But listen to what Isaiah writes. He says, "Thus saith the Lord, the heaven is my throne, and the earth is my footstool. Where is the house that ye built unto me? And where is the place of my rest?" The heavens is where God sits. The earth is where he props his feet. Amen. That is how big God is. This world was created for the glory of God. And for us to glorify God. God has placed his glory on every part of creation. And then you know what he does, Sister Stacy? He places us a little lower than the angels. We're above the animal, Brother Doug. They don't have souls. And then he gives us his name that gives us power. When we call upon the name of Jesus and he forgives us of our sins, we have power with him. The God of all this creation allows us than to call upon Him. In John 15:7, He said, if we abide in Him and our words abide in us, then we shall ask anything. In this universe of great vastness, God still wants to hear from us. Talking about a God who is taking care of a big, big old universe. But yet us who are so very small, but yet created by God and in the image of God, God wants to hear from us.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. He said that if we draw near to Him, we can come boldly before His throne of grace. In Jeremiah 29:19, He says, when we call upon Him, that the Lord will answer us. Amen. That if we pray in the power of the Spirit, amen, God will hear our prayers. Amen. Listen, I know that we live in a day that's jaded by politics and by a world of gaining lots of things, lots of opportunity, but don't become so jaded that you forget that God has placed you in a glorious place. Amen. And more than anything else, He wants to hear and know from you. Hallelujah. And He wants us to give Him praise. Bible says in verse number 6, you made Him to have dominion over the works of your hands, and you have put all things under His feet. And then He finishes up in verse number 9, He says, O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. So you mean this God that's taking care of everything in the universe and billion and billions of people still has time to be a personal God to me? Yes. That's what David was saying. And when he fought the battle, when he took the name of God, that name that's bigger than any other name in this world, when he spoke the name of God, the giant came down. And God said, now, you know what, David? I know your heart is all about worship. Why don't you take that guitar from Dad? And why don't you get those fingers strumming on it? And why don't you write a song for all of Israel and all of my people to know that they may sing glory to my name? Your situation tonight, whatever it is, will only be conquered in one way, and that is in a name that is bigger than you. The name of Jesus. And whatever you are facing, God wants to turn that around and make it a victory song. Because in the middle of all creation, as vast as it is, God keeps you and I as the apple of His eye. Tonight, I may not have told you anything that you do not know. I may have shared scripture that you've read hundreds and hundreds of times. But if I can make it real to you of the miracle of who He is, just as the sun rising every morning. Moses, he said He made the moon and the stars. Hey, don't forget it goes farther than that. Or the moon and the sun. There's lots of stars out there that He knows by name. You know, we're still just learning stars. But God already had all of them by name long before Brother Josh they were ever saw the Hubble telescope. He knows. And tonight, He knows what you need.
and warrior. And he's going to give you a victory song over no matter what you're in. Sister Beth would come to the piano tonight. I wonder if this evening I wonder if we could sing with David. I don't know what David looked like, that red-headed ruddy man. I mean, dude, you talk about a man.